This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of the month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 149. Hallelujah! Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing his praise in the congregation of the faithful. Let Israel rejoice in his Maker.
Let the children of Zion be joyful in their King.
Let them praise his name in the dance.
Let them sing praise to him with timbrel and harp.
For the Lord takes pleasure in his people
and adorns the poor with victory.
Let the faithful rejoice in triumph.
Let them be joyful on their beds.
Let the praises of God be in their throat
and a two-edged sword in their hand,
to wreak vengeance on the nations
and punishment on the peoples,
to bind their kings in chains
and their nobles with links of iron,
to inflict on them the judgment decreed.
This is glory for all his faithful people. Hallelujah.
Second lesson is a reading from the book of Romans. Owe no one anything except to love one another, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. struggle. In today's gospel, which is, again, a message to the gathered, a message to all of us together, is about how to overcome conflict in our society, in our communities. And it's a gospel that we need to hear at this time than perhaps as much as we needed to hear it at any other time in our history. Before I talk a little bit about that, I feel a need, I don't know if warning is the right word, but I feel a need maybe alert you to the fact that I believe deep in my bones that at this particular time in our history, that listening to this story and heeding the message, the direction that it provides to us, is much more important than to me and folks who look like me, folks who are white and privileged and have power and authority, than it is to those who are not blessed, or I don't know, blessed is a bad word, but not by an accident of birth, given white skin. And it's a message to us because it is our often pathological need to stop listening to the stories that challenge us, that make us uncomfortable, that hold us to an accountability that those who don't have our privilege and our power and our influence do not have to hold. It speaks to our tendency to think we have all the answers and that our way is the best or the only way. A tendency we get to act on because of the benefits of being born with the privilege and the power and the influence that comes from having white skin. And again, this is an accident of birth, that we were born looking like we do, just as it's a similar accident of birth, happy accidents all, that other people were not. I also want to be clear that I am not blaming any one of us for being white or for the decisions that people before us have made in terms of behavior and policies and all the things that have created the systems and the structures that we have inherited and that we continue to benefit from. What I am doing is naming those realities and the ways in which we then have specific responsibilities and accountabilities as a result. Although this may not be at all comfortable to hear, this really is about the call to love thy neighbor in our particular context, in the community of people that is the country and the world today. Again, to be clear, their desire to hang on to the status quo in our power. We are called to listen. True listening, deep listening, life-changing listening, means listening to the cries of our siblings, whether we hear them once or a million times over 400 years. It means listening deeply, whether we hear the cry of one person or many gathered together. It means listening for the truth, not just listening to get it over with. To achieve true peace and reconciliation, we must be willing to sit in our discomfort, often that deep discomfort, as we listen to the ways that we, not anyone as individuals necessarily, but we as a specific part of the community, have failed and continue to fail to honor and celebrate the dignity and worth of every human being. As we listen, we must be open to hearing both what has been done to cause harm, that is the cultural sin part, and what those who have been harmed need in order to be restored to their rightful place in the community. In order to have reconciliation, we must acknowledge truth, especially those truths that make us cringe, that interfere with or challenge our perception of reality. As people of faith, we are called to bear witness, not to push aside or rush through, not to minimize or discount, not to say yes, but in the myriad ways that we do. Yes, but that was in the past. Yes, but I myself didn't have anything to do with that. Yes, but. And I'm sure you can fill in some blanks. We are called, first and foremost, to listen, to accompany those who have truths to tell, not to tell our versions of their truths, but to be present and visible in our support. We are called to listen to the anger and frustration of literally hundreds of years of oppression and violence against their bodies, without making excuses, without blaming the victim, without imposing solutions that may or may not bring us any closer to true peace and reconciliation. And though our tendency is to treat the victims of oppression and violence as the ones who should be looked upon as a Gentile and as a tax collector, we must be honest with ourselves that if Jesus were here with us today, he would be challenging us to do the reverse. If Jesus were here with us today, he would once again be standing with those whose humanity and dignity are being undermined and degraded by those who have privilege and power. Jesus would be reminding us that we will be forever bound by the limitations
and for the world. God of love, we pray for your church, for Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, Carly Hughes, our bishop, for all lay and ordained ministers, and for all who seek you in the community of the faithful. Equip us with compassion and love to carry out your work of reconciliation in the world. God of love,
hear our prayers for the church.
God of freedom, we pray for our nation and all the nations of the world, for peace and unity across barriers of language, color, and creed, for elected and appointed leaders, that they would serve the common good. Inspire all people with courage to speak out against hatred, to actively resist evil. Unite the human family in bonds of love. God of freedom,
hear our prayers
for the world. God of justice, we pray for the earth, your creation entrusted to our care, for the animals and birds, the mountains and oceans, and all parts of your creation that have no voice of their own. Stir up in us a thirst for justice that protects the earth and all its resources, that we may leave to our children's children the legacy of beauty and abundance that you have given us. God of justice,
hear our prayers
for the earth. God of peace, we pray for this community, for our local leaders, for our schools and markets, for our neighborhoods and workplaces. Kindle in every heart a desire for equality, respect, and opportunity for all. Give us courage to strive for justice and peace among all people, beginning here at home. God of peace,
hear our prayers for this community.
God of mercy, we pray for all in any kind of need or trouble, for those whose lives are closely linked with ours and those connected to us as part of the human family, for refugees and prisoners, for the sick and suffering, the lonely and despairing, for those facing violence, for all held down by prejudice or injustice. Awaken in us compassion and humility of spirit as we seek and serve Christ in all persons. God of mercy,
hear our prayers for all who are in need.
Let us pray for Jeff Loggins, Jimmy Hasenkamp, Ian Genesco, the McManus family, the Blanchard family, Donna Ridgey, Eleanor Robinson, Bernard and Nathan, the Fitzgerald family, Jack Marino, Stephanie Gubin, Sue Macbeth, Francis, Marcia Min, Christine Conti, Xander, Evan, Sarah Ruth Dorn, Felder Dorn, James Tranberg, Debbie and Jeff Robarge, and Grace Biddy. God of grace, we pray for those who have died, especially for Freda Williams, for the faithful in every generation who have worked for justice, for prophets who called us to racial reconciliation, for martyrs who died because of hatred, and for all the communion of saints. Make us faithful to your call to proclaim your good news by word and example, and bring us at last into the glorious company of the saints in light. God of grace,
hear our prayers for those who have died. Hear our prayers, Holy God. Breathe your spirit over us and all the earth, that barriers would crumble and division cease. Make us more fully your co-healers of the broken world. Unite us with all people in bonds of love, that the whole earth and all its people may be at peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray together. God of all power and love, we give thanks for your unfailing
also with you.
And may the peace of Christ, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. In the name of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer.
Amen.